Good morning, and thank you for joining us this morning for Winship Grand Rounds. If you're an Emory University or healthcare employee and would like to receive a CME credit hour for attending today, the login information can be found in the chat feature on the bottom of your screen. If you have any issues with this webinar or the CME login, please send Julie Hawkins an email or drop a note via the chat feature. This morning, we are excited, and it's my honor to welcome Dr. Thomas Hope, who has also gotten up at 4:30 in the morning in California time to do this talk for us. Dr. Hope is a director of molecular therapy in the Department of Radiology and Biomedical Imaging at the University of California, San Francisco. He is also the associate chair for Joint Ventures for Radiology. He serves as chief of nuclear medicine at the San Francisco VA Medical Center. He also serves as chair of the Cancer Center's Molecular Imaging and Radionuclide Therapy Site Committee. In 2007, he received his medical degree from Stanford University School of Medicine, and he completed a one-year internship at Kaiser Permanente San Francisco. From 2008 to 2012, Dr. Hope completed a residency in diagnostic radiology at the University of California, San Francisco, followed by a clinical fellowship in body MR and nuclear medicine from Stanford. Dr. Hope's main research focus is on novel imaging agents and therapies, particularly in prostate cancer and neuroendocrine tumors. He led the development of gallium-68 PSMA-11, which subsequently led to the approval of this drug by the FDA. He has combined his interest in MR imaging with PET in the simultaneous modality PET-MR, helping lead the development of the clinical PET-MR program. Additionally, he leads the peptide receptor radionuclide therapy program for neuroendocrine tumors at UCSF. An international leader in PET-MR research and the translation of new molecular imaging agents, Dr. Hope launched the highly successful PSMA prostate program at UCSF and championed the use of multiple new targeted therapies to treat patients with neuroendocrine and other tumors. He currently serves as principal investigator on grants from the NIH and the Prostate Cancer Foundation, among others. He is the recipient of numerous accolades in molecular imaging, including the Henkin Fellowship and Mark Tunnelman Memorial Award from the Society of Nuclear Medicine and Molecular Imaging, as well as the Young Investigator Award from the Prostate Cancer Foundation and the Wiley J. Dodds Research Award from the Society of Abdominal Radiology. Welcome, Dr. Hope.
Thank you, David, for that very, very thorough introduction. I appreciate it. Thank you for inviting me to give this talk. I always love presenting about PSMA PET, and particularly I'm excited to present at Emory, although I have to say I would have loved to have been in there in person. Your group has done some incredible work, as we'll very briefly talk about, and hopefully you can comment on after we're done. And it's just an honor to be able to share with you my experiences with PSMA PET, which is going to be approved nationwide again very, very soon, hopefully. So let's get cracking. So PSMA PET and moving forward with imaging and therapy. I guess at the end we'll do questions, but if you also want to just chat, I can also answer questions as we're going through the talk. These are my disclosures, some of which are maybe ancillarily related to the talk. So first, we'll start with introduction to PSMA PET, and then we'll talk about how PSMA PET impacts patients in clinical trials, and then we'll talk about theranostics and using PSMA as a therapeutic target with radioligand therapy. So to talk about introduction to PSMA. So PSMA stands for, obviously, prostate-specific membrane. It's a transmembrane protein that's overexpressed on prostate cancer cells. Oddly enough, it's not actually specific to prostate cancer. It's also expressed in other tumors, such as renal cell carcinoma and in the vascular endothelium and neovascularity in things such as ovarian cancer and thyroid cancer. So it can be seen in many other cancers, but it's most highly expressed in prostate cancer. And as we'll talk about, some benign diseases also express PSMA. This protein was actually targeted a long time ago. with processant. For those of you who have been around for a while, you'll remember processant was an antibody that actually, unfortunately, was designed to bind to the intracellular component of this protein. And so really, prostate cancer cells had to be necrotic in order for processant to get inside the tumor cell. And so this whole field changed when small molecules that bound to the extracellular component of this protein were discovered and then radiolabeled and used for imaging. The protein that we've used, or protein, the molecule that we used at UCSF primarily is this small molecule called gallium-68 PSMA-11. And I show the molecule because it's sort of important to think about what these look like, and it'll be important when we think about all the other radiotracers that are being developed in the field. So one half of the molecule is a chelator. This chelator is labeled HBED-CC, and so you might remember the gallium-68 PSMA-11 used to be called HBED-CC PSMA. To reference this chelator. This is what binds to the gallium-68. It should be noted this chelator doesn't bind to lutetium or other therapeutic radiometals very effectively, and so it can't be used for therapy. It can only really be used for imaging, but it binds to gallium very effectively. On the other half of the molecule is the targeting molecule, the urea motif. This is what binds to PSMA and gives the specificity to the molecule for PSMA. And this is what's shared across this class of PSMA-targeted radiopharmaceuticals. This is this little motif that binds to PSMA. Then we put gallium into the chelator, and then we image that gallium using a PET scanner, positron emission tomography. And it works quite well. So here's an example of a man, 69-year-old, status post radical prostatectomy, who has a PSA of 0.6. And you can see very nicely how this imaging agent can show you both osseous disease, an example in this patient's right humerus, as well as a soft tissue disease in this left internal iliac node. And we're not getting far away from the time where PSMA PET will replace CT and bone scan for the staging of prostate cancer patients. I think we're within a year or two of when that standard staging will then be replaced by a single imaging study, in this case, a PSMA PET. Now, as I was saying, there's a whole host of these molecules out there. So for example, we have on the bottom left, DCF-PYL. That is a drug that's going to be hopefully FDA approved at the end of this month. It's a fluorinated compound. On the bottom right there is PSMA-617. That's the agent that's used for therapy in the VISION trial. And there's also a host of other molecules, which I haven't even put on this screen. But they all, in essence, share a commonality, which is this urea motif, which binds to the PSMA molecule. And so I think of them as a class because they have a very similar sensitivity for the detection of prostate cancer. If you look across them, the chelator, that thing that's attached to the urea motif, really changes primarily the biodistribution. So on the left here, we have PSMA-11. PSMA-1007 is a molecule that's actually in phase 3 trials right now in the United States. It has a lot of liver uptake, as you can see here, not a lot of bladder excretion or renal excretion. And the idea here is you'll be able to see local recurrence potentially better using PSMA-1007. You have DCF-PYL, which in essence looks very, very similar to PSMA-11 in terms of its biodistribution. I threw this compound here, CTT-1057. This is the only compound that uses a different motif from the urea motif. It uses a inhibitor to PSMA, and this was developed at UCSF. And this may be entering phase 3 trials also in the near future, but I'm not quite sure when that will be happening. Now, PSMA-11 obviously was FDA approved in December of last year, and the DCF-PYL had an NDA submitted in September of 2020. And so we're anticipating, as I mentioned, this to become FDA approved maybe by the end of this month, if nothing goes wrong with the FDA. Now, remember I said that PSMA is not specific to prostate cancer. I'll just quickly go through a number of the false positive issues that we have with PSMA PET. And the first is these rib lesions. And this is actually maybe the single biggest problem with PSMA PET is solitary rib lesions. And in this lesion, you can see there's clearly focal uptake there in the PSMA PET, but there's a sclerotic, peripherally sclerotic lesion within the rib. And this is a common false positive. I'm not sure what these are. Maybe they're enchondromas. There's also fibrous dysplasia, as you can see in this area, can have focal uptake. But it's important to remember that solitary rib lesions can oftentimes be false positives, and you really want to look at the CT correlate to see whether or not it's actually metastatic disease or one of these mimics of metastatic disease. You can also have a lesion like this, which is a true positive lesion, a solitary rib lesion, and it's extended along the length of the rib. You can see here, instead of being focal, it's elongated, similar to how we would imagine a bone scan having an elongated uptake along the rib being a true positive lesion. We also have presacral ganglia. This has been well described. Sometimes you'll see it's actually sort of, there's bilateral presacral ganglia here. They're elongated, facing anterior, posterior, right in front of the sacrum. I think a lot of people who are just starting interpreting PSMA PETs will think of these as nodal metastases, but this is actually just a presacral ganglia. You can also get dorsal root ganglia, similar uptake in the dorsal root ganglia. You can have hemangiomas. Here's a spinal hemangioma. Can have some uptake on PSMA PETs. There's been reported uptake in hepatic hemangiomas. Here's an example of Paget's disease, right? Uptake. You have cortical thickening, very avid PSMA uptake. Fibrous dysplasia will have also uptake as well. Here's an example of fibrous dysplasia in the skull base. You can see focal uptake there on the PSMA, expansile, ground glass appearance on the CT, a classic example of fibrous dysplasia with PSMA uptake. Other tumors, so here's an example of hepatocellular carcinoma with PSMA uptake. This is an example, obviously, of lung cancer with PSMA uptake. I think lung nodules are sort of a problem because obviously you can have metastases to the lung, but if you have a solitary lung nodule, particularly if it's spiculated, it doesn't really matter how much PSMA avidity it is. There can be a chance that that's lung cancer. So you can see this is very, very avid on the PSMA PET, but this ended up being a pulmonary adenocarcinoma. So lung cancer is something you do have to be concerned about when you have a solitary pulmonary nodule. Also looking at the course of the change in size of that pulmonary nodule over time to see whether or not it's completely new in the setting of rising PSA, that might be something that's gonna be more likely to be adenocarcinoma versus a nodule that's been growing independent of the PSA over time would probably suggest lung cancer over prostate cancer. So those are the false positive interpretations. Now there's a lot of imaging pitfalls. One of them would be seen here is the ureters, and this is actually the opposite. This is a true positive. You can see a lymph node here directly behind the ureter, and the lymph node is actually hot, whereas the ureter is negative. This was actually mistakenly thought to represent ureteral activity, but when you looked at it more carefully, it ended up being nodal activity just posterior to the ureter. You can obviously have the opposite, where you have hot activity in the urine from the renal excretion of the radiotracer mimicking nodal disease as well. Now, in disease that's right around the bladder base, you can have issues with distinguishing it from the adjacent bladder activity. So here you can see the activity in the bladder, but directly inferior to it, you can see the focal uptake corresponding to these two enhancing nodules at the base of the bladder, which is an example here of local recurrence. So you have to be very careful with PSMA PET when you're looking just at the bottom of the bladder. And I really do have to say having either a contrast enhanced CT or MR is helpful for correlation here and making your eye look to see where this disease might be. But this can be a problem having it directly adjacent to the bladder. But just, you know, if you think about how you're going to window it and looking at it, you can read through it. Here's an example of a patient who's actually after a TURP. He had focal a TURP defect asymmetrically here in the prostate bed with focal uptake. And when you looked at the delayed CT of the pelvis, contrast actually collected in that TURP defect in the prostate. And this was actually just urine activity asymmetrically in the prostate. So you just need to pay attention, think about where the disease, what the correlate looks like on contrast and CT. You see here, there's no enhancement. It's actually hypodense, consistent with a defect rather than recurrent cancer. And then obviously the thing we sort of all worry about is PSMA negative disease, maybe around 5% of cancers. And this is at initial staging are negative on PSMA PET. And you can see here on the MR, there's restricted diffusion, high signal intensity on the high B value image, a low ADC, but really nothing seen on the PSMA PET and actually the uptake on the PSMA PETs on the contralateral side to the prostate. And so you will have patients who have PSMA negative tumors. And in these patients, although this hasn't really been looked into, it's pretty safe to assume that this patient, if they had nodal mets, PSMA PETs not going to visualize them. And this might be a setting where other radiotracers might play a role. And here's an example of looking for obstruction of the ureter showing you recurrent disease that can be subtle. So you can see here urine activity piled up in the right ureter, nothing seen in the left ureter. And as you come down, you see how the ureter is distended. And we come down to the right orifice here, and you can see there's soft tissue right here. And that soft tissue has low level PSMA uptake, whereas the ureter actually has much higher PSMA uptake because the urine can be quite avid. But you can clearly see that this is actually recurrent disease. And so this can be an issue when you're interpreting it to see this disease and determine that it's distinct from the adjacent ureteral activity and note that there's obstruction caused by this recurrent disease causing the collection of the urine activity in the ureter. Historically, we're giving Lasix to all of our patients, and we did that primarily based on the quality of our CT scanners. But now that we've upgraded to pretty much all digital scanners, we've no longer given Lasix because our scanners don't have any artifact around this, and you can see the activity adjacent to the bladder fairly accurately without the use of Lasix. So overall, though, PSMA PET works quite well, like you can see in this patient. Last segment was just highlighting the weaknesses, but in general, you have patients like this, again, low PSA after radical prostatectomy showing us two nodal metastases very clearly. In a patient like this where you have high uptake in your nodes and you can see it very clearly, you feel very confident that you're seeing the total extent of disease, right? In patients who have much more subtle disease where the uptake's not as avid, in that case, you might be concerned. You might be missing other sites of disease because of the low uptake. But overall, PSMA PET functions quite well. These are two studies comparing PSMA PET to fluorocholine. Not all of us might remember this, but fluorocholine, particularly outside of the US, was used to stage prostate cancer very, very frequently. And on the left there is the first study that really sort of piqued my interest back in 2014, comparing PSMA PET to fluorocholine, showing a higher sensitivity with PSMA compared to fluorocholine. But it's important to note that that paper had a PSA average of 11, a much later stage population with a higher volume of disease. And you don't see that difference in detection sensitivity if you have a very high PSA. A CT scan might have a 50% detection sensitivity as you get your PSA high enough. The follow-up study, this was at a St. Vincent's in Sydney with Louise Emmett, had one more patient. I always joke that I'm going to wait till I get my 39th patient and publish a similar study. But now there's multiple other studies since these two have been published. The reason this paper was so important was that mean PSA was so much lower, PSA of 1.7. And you can see as your PSA goes down, the detection sensitivity goes down for both PSMA and choline, but much more so for fluorocholine. And it's at these low PSAs where you're going to have a much higher chance of having a significant impact in the outcome of that patient because they're more likely to have oligometastatic disease. So having a higher sensitivity, a low PSA is really important. This is where PSMA PET shines. Now, I hate to do this at a talk to Emory, but I do think it's important to compare PSMA to fluciclovine. So here's a patient that was imaged a week apart with fluciclovine and PSMA. And this is commonly what you see with fluciclovine, right? So you can see here that there is a right pelvic sidewall node, clearly has uptake on fluciclovine. But if you look at the tumor to background ratio, it's something around 3, right? The uptake in the tumor, the SUV max in this case was a 3.9. The background SUV max was maybe 1.2. You can see there's just a lot more background activity with fluciclovine in general. And there's also more marrow uptake than you see with PSMA PET. Now in the PSMA PET, the tumor to background ratio is something like 60 or 50, right? Much higher tumor to background ratio is what gives you the higher ability to actually confidently see that disease and distinguish it from sort of background noise. Now, also note that the high uptake helps you distinguish it from bladder activity. And I think that's important in this next case. You can see here's a case of recurrent disease in the prostate bed. You can see it on the fluciclovine, but it's very subtle, right? The tumor to background ratio is less than 2. Whereas in this case, although there's more uptake in the bladder, the tumor to background ratio is more like 10. And I can very confidently tell that that's recurrent disease in the right seminal vesicle, right? So the tumor to background is really what's helping you get higher detection sensitivity, particularly in patients who have lower PSAs compared to fluciclovine. And this was studied prospectively by the UCLA group, where they did a head-to-head comparison of PSMA 11 to fluciclovine. And this should be noted, this was in a patient population after radical prostatectomy with a PSA less than 2. So selecting out a low PSA population, right? Although that's the population where this is going to be most clinically relevant. And they showed that the overall detection sensitivity of PSMA PET was twice as high as fluciclune, and most importantly, had, in essence, a much higher sensitivity for nodal and metastatic disease than fluciclovine, whereas fluciclovine saw primarily local disease in this patient population. And I think one of the things that's really important is fluciclovine can be a pretty hard study to interpret. Now, maybe at Emory, you guys have David Schuster, who's one of the world's experts on this, so maybe his intro reader variability will be higher. But this study used three expert readers from around the world, and the Cohen's kappa was 0.2 for fluciclovine versus 0.67 for PSMA. And I think it's this reproducibility that's actually a really important aspect of PSMA PET in the fact that people can interpret it more reliably than other radiotracers. One other thing, and this is sort of a funny slide, so I'll be intrigued at the end what David thinks of this. Bone lesions can be hard with fluciclovine. So here's an example of a patient who was imaged within a month of each other. On the left there using a fluciclovine PET, on the right using a PSMA PET. And all of these osteocytes of disease, you can barely see on the fluciclovine. I think this sort of left acetabular lesion or inferior pubic ramus lesion, you might be able to appreciate. This right humeral lesion you can see, right femoral lesion you can see. With the spinal lesion, you can't appreciate, nor the right humeral lesion. And so actually at the VA, we've gone forward and done a thing where we actually give sodium fluoride with fluciclovine. We give 5 millicuries of sodium fluoride before, 45 minutes before we do the fluciclovine PET and inject the fluciclovine dynamically on the table. And it does help us see these sort of more subtle osseous lesions that I think you would miss if you were using fluciclovine alone. I think this might only be possible in a VA setting where you don't have to worry about reimbursement issues of giving two radiotracers. But it's one of the solutions we've come up with in an environment where we don't have PSMA available, and we felt like we were missing a lot of osseous disease. And now that we have fluciclovine at the VA, people were no longer ordering bone scans or sodium fluoride PETs. So in order to get that osseous staging, we were doing a combination here to try to increase our detection sensitivity for fluciclovine PET. Okay. So that's sort of my overview introduction of PSMA. And now let's talk about how PSMA PET impacts patient care. And I think it's really remarkable how the field and the landscape of prostate cancer is going to change in the coming years with the introduction of PSMA PET. So if we think about prostate cancer, this is a standard sort of diagram of the flow of patients, right? At initial staging of primary treatment prior to radical prostatectomy and radiation therapy, PSMA PET does have a role for detecting metastatic disease. Now here is a PETMR study, and you can see on this T2 weighted image very nicely, the extracapsular extension, the primary tumor, restricted diffusion, very clearly seen on the high V-value image, and that correlates nicely with the PSMA PET. But this isn't particularly clinically relevant. By the time someone's gotten a PSMA PET, they've already been biopsied, typically using a truss biopsy. They may have already gotten an MRI of the prostate because that's usually done before the biopsy in most patients. So we already know the T stage. We knew that there was seminal vesicle invasion. The real question was, did the patient have metastatic disease, right? So we have the primary tumor, but we didn't know whether or not this 8 millimeter left internal iliac node was actually positive or not. But when you do the PSMA PET, you can clearly see that that was a nodal metastasis, and that is what has clinical impact on the patient. Now, I will say, now that we know this patient has pelvic nodal disease, actually, I don't know what the right thing to do is. Should this patient go to radical prostatectomy and the surgeon take out that node, or should this patient get radiation therapy because they have disease outside of the prostate, or should they get systemic therapy because this node indicates that they have metastatic disease, actually not metastatic disease, but nodal disease. And I think that will be answered in the coming years, and it'll take a long time for these trials to read out, where randomized trials are now being based upon what the PSMA PET staging looks like up front. Now, UCSF, we did a study at time of prostatectomy comparing PSMA PET versus pathology. And in this study, we did 277 patients who went to prostatectomy. And remember, this was done in collaboration with UCLA. So about half of those patients were at UCLA and half were at UCSF. And in this study, there were 75 patients who were positive in pathology. And we only saw 30% or 30 lymph nodes of those 75 patients, which resulted in a sensitivity of 40%, but had a specificity of 95%. So generally, if you saw positive disease on a PSMA PET. It's real. We just didn't see all of the lymph nodes. And if you actually went back retrospectively, five of those false positives were clearly true positive disease where the surgeons weren't able to get to the nodes. And on a repeat PSMA PET after surgery, you could see that the nodes were left behind accidentally and that the patients had persistent PSA levels consistent with the biochemical persistence. And so the sensitivity is maybe a little higher, maybe like 45% rather than 40%. But overall, the negative predictive value in the initial staging setting is really not high enough to exclude pelvic nodal dissections, or at least I think that's our understanding. I think more work has to be done to evaluate what to do in a patients who have a negative PSMA PET prior to prostatectomy, but have high risk disease, Gleason 4+5 or 5+5 disease at the time of surgery. And that needs to be further evaluated. Now, radiation therapy at initial staging can really benefit from PSMA PET. So here's an example of a patient who had biochemical recurrence after radiation therapy. And you can see that there's a little left pelvic sidewall lymph node, maybe 3 millimeters in diameter. And this lymph node was present prior to RT. So this was the radiation therapy plan. And you can see the little lymph node sitting right there on the left pelvic sidewall that was present prior to doing radiation therapy. And it would have been really helpful for the radiation oncologist to know that that node was there so that they could have aimed and treated this site of disease prior to giving definitive radiotherapy to the prostate bed. It would have been really easy just to sort of paint up here and include it. Now that he's recurrent, it's very close to the prior radiation therapy field, so it can actually be difficult to treat this without causing toxicity because of the overlapping radiation fields. And this is the only site of recurrence in this patient. At UCSF, we went back retrospectively and looked in our initial staging cohort, and there were 45 patients with high-risk disease at initial staging who underwent radiation therapy planning. And of these 45 patients, 53% of them had changes in their radiation therapy plans based on the PSMA PET. 12 of them had boosts to nodes in the radiation field, like in this patient. 6 of them had radiation therapy to osseous disease that was additionally seen. And then 8 patients had lymph nodes outside of the consensus tumor volume. And so the point here is that PSMA PET can really impact radiation therapy planning as well. And this is a really important use of PSMA PET moving forward. Now, I like to do these little thought experiments about how PSMA PET will impact our interpretation of trial data. And so one example is the CHARTED trial. I'm sure many of you are aware of this. Back from 2015. This was a trial which compared ADT to ADT with docetaxel. And they stratified this trial to patients with low volume disease and high volume disease. And on the top right here, this is the outcome in patients with high volume disease. And they showed that ADT plus docetaxel was beneficial to patients with high volume disease, but was not beneficial in patients with low volume disease. And this was based on a bone scan. Did you have greater than or equal to 4 osseous metastases on a bone scan? Now, I have no idea how to interpret a PSMA PET to determine whether or not that patient had greater than or equal to 4 bone metastases. And clearly, bone mets in this setting is indicating a volume of disease, right? The higher your volume of disease, the more benefit you're going to get from docetaxel. With PSMA PET, you're going to be more sensitive to lower volume disease. So is 4 osseous mets the same as 4 mets seen on bone scan? Clearly not. So we will have struggle with how to apply this type of data in the setting of PSMA PET. And I think as we go forward in time, we're going to have to really struggle with how to apply these types of criteria. There's also another trial, which I think highlights sort of the opposite side of the problem. This was a Stampede RTM1 trial. Well, the Stampede trial is the RTM1 arm of that trial. And what they did in this trial is they actually did sort of a sub-randomization of giving radiotherapy to the prostate bed in patients who would have met, in essence, criteria for the CHARTED trial. So they had to have metastatic disease. But when you did radiotherapy to the prostate bed in the setting of metastatic disease, the opposite was true in this setting, right? The addition of radiation therapy to the prostate bed was only seen to be beneficial in patients who had low volume disease, right? So this is this top row here. If you had low volume disease, then you would benefit from getting RT. Now, this means that in patients who had 3 or fewer bone lesions, those patients benefited, right? Now, how would that be interpreted in the setting of PSMA PET. Is PSMA PET thought to be more sensitive than bone scan? So maybe I should allow 5 or 6 osseous mets on a PSMA PET to allow for prostate bed radiotherapy? I'm not actually really sure. And I'm a little worried the opposite is true. So here's an example of 3 patients imaged at UCSF on bone scan and PSMA PET. And the bone scans were read as equivocal or positive. And you can see that there's no uptake on the correlated PSMA PET. And it's actually very possible that in the low volume arm, there's actually a good number of false positive bone scans due to either degenerative disease, lesions that are reactive or fractures or other reasons that could be causing a false positive on a bone scan. And you can imagine if you're trying to enroll patients on the Stampede M1RT trial, you might be sort of inclined to overinterpret a site of disease as being positive on a bone scan to help a patient get onto the study. And so actually it might be the opposite, that on the Stampede RTM1, you want a negative PSMA PET. And in that case, the benefit might actually be seen from giving definitive, in essence, nearly curative RT to a localized site of disease rather than debulking disease in the setting of metastatic disease. So I think we, again, are really going to struggle to understand how to apply PSMA PET in these patient populations as we move forward. Okay, let's go look at biochemical recurrence in the PSA recurrence setting. Now, I always like this slide. This is a slide from UCSF. Well before I was even a physician. I was in high school in 1996, which is a little disturbing. But the point here is that the location of recurrence is dependent on technology. So this was done by a urologist, and they were debating where the location of recurrence is based on proximity to the anastomotic site. And this was the only way they knew where disease was by biopsy. So this was the only locations they could actually tell where recurrent prostate cancer was, because there was no real way for them to visualize metastatic disease effectively back in 1996. So this was the discussion because of the limited in technology. And I'm sure in 15 years, there'll be something that replaces PSMA PET, and we'll have a whole new understanding of where metastatic disease is in patients with prostate cancer. Now, this is the trial data from UCSF and UCLA that was published now 2 years ago in JAMA Oncology. And we looked at 635 patients, average PSA of 2.1 with biochemical recurrence. We used 3 blinded readers, and we had this sort of composite endpoint where we combined imaging outcomes afterwards to see if those lesions that were seen on PSMA PET grew or became sclerotic on a bone scan. And 93 of the patients had histologic validation. And you can see with the histopath that there was a positive predictive value of 0.84. The composite endpoint had a higher positive predictive value, which is not that surprising, given that a lot of these were sclerotic lesions seen on bone scan. And in this case, there's not going to be, in essence, negative correlates. If you had an uptake, but there was no sclerosis, that didn't count it to be a negative. So sort of a little bias of the composite endpoint. But overall, one of the other benefits was that the inter-rater variability was very high, again, here mostly above 0.7, so very good reproducibility. And as in all the PSMA PET studies, the higher your PSA, the higher your detection sensitivity. And here with the PSA less than 0.5, we had a sensitivity of 0.38, which sounds maybe not that high, but you have to remember that when you're using multiple blinded readers, your sensitivity falls, right? Because you have to agree with the other 3 readers. If you have a single center retrospective study, and we have studies like this at UCSF as well, our sensitivity is higher, but that's biased because you're, in essence, biased to be positive on the interpretation of the PSMA PET. And again, we did a similar thing with PSMA PET in the biochemical recurrence setting, looking at the impact of PSMA PET on RT planning. And you can see here, this is 125 patients with a PSA less than 2 after radical prostatectomy. And we found that about half of those patients had PSMA positive disease, and 30% of the 125 patients had disease that would be missed by standard radiation therapy fields. And this is actually sort of interesting, because if you think about it, this 30% is, if you look at this patient population in older trials, the recurrence after salvage radiotherapy, after radical prostatectomy, is about 30% after 2 years. And so really it's likely that RT is failing because they're not treating the total extent of disease. And I think when you start to include PSMA PET into radiation therapy planning, we're gonna have a much higher success rate of biochemical cure with patients in this setting. And I think this is really the change in management that you're seeing, right? So if you come in here, if you have no disease, we're seeing patients who get active surveillance. If you have no disease, all these patients are going to start to migrate and get radiation therapy to their nodal disease. And then in patients who have systemic disease, they get systemic therapy if you have metastatic disease. So there's this massive shift in the treatment of patients who are imaged with PSMA PET because we're localizing their disease. And there's this huge increase in patients who are giving radiation therapy to oligometastatic disease. And I think this is sort of highlighted nicely by a trial that was just published out of your group, right? The Empire One trial. And Ashish Jani did a wonderful job with this trial along with David Schuster. And I do admire this title, Empire One. So I'm looking forward to, as we'll talk about in a couple of slides, the Empire Two trial that will be coming along. And in this trial, they took a similar population, right? Post-radical prostatectomy, biochemical recurrence, and their primary endpoint was, quote, event-free survival. But it seems like the event-free survival matched fairly closely biochemical-free survival. And you can see here, this was the diagram in the figure in the Lancet paper that was just published. The fluciclovin group had a better event-free survival than the conventional arm group, which had a borderline p-value in the log rank, but the biochemical-free survival was much higher at 4 years with the inclusion of fluciclovine PET in terms of planning for the radiation therapy, sort of again suggesting that if we can localize that disease, that radiation therapy can be dramatically improved. Now, the question is, how does this play out when you use PSMA PET? It works with fluciclovine, but does it work for PSMA? And so there is a similar trial that's being run out of UCLA where they did a very similar thing, took patients and did a control arm with standard imaging, a treatment arm with a PSMA PET, and had very similar outcomes. Now, I'll be very intrigued. It would be very hard to compare these two trials, right? One with fluciclovine and one with PSMA PET. It's possible that fluciclovine and PSMA will function similarly in both of these settings. What do I mean by that? Now, I'm fairly confident that PSMA has a higher sensitivity for detecting smaller sites of disease, right? The lower your PSA, the more likely you're going to see disease. It may be that the disease seen on PSMA isn't going to have as big of an impact on patient outcomes as the disease seen on fluciclovine. Fluciclovine might see bulkier, larger disease that including that in your RT planning is going to have a bigger impact on the overall outcome of that patient. And so it's not entirely clear to me how much more benefit we're going to see by including PSMA PET in this setting. Now, maybe this arm here will plateau out at maybe 0.9 instead of 0.8 or something like that. But it'll be interesting to see how this plays out. But I think a trial, and I don't have a nice diagram for this trial, is what I don't know will be what maybe the Empire 2 is another trial being run at Emory by Ashish Jani and David Schuster, is doing the same type of trial, but comparing fluciclovine to PSMA to see if there is actually an additive benefit of PSMA over fluciclovine. And this is currently enrolling. I think this will be a very interesting study to see, and this will tease out whether or not that higher sensitivity, seeing smaller sites of disease, is actually beneficial compared to what you're seeing with just fluciclovine PET. And I think, you know, and I think Emory, your group is doing some of the really great work here, and we had the foresight to do a lot of this randomized work, because soon, you know, with PSMA PET becoming available nationwide in a couple of months, you won't be able to enroll in these trials anymore. So I'm really hoping that this trial's getting close to completing enrollment, because it'll be harder and harder to randomize patients to the study when PSMA PET is widely available. Now, the last area to talk about is castration-resistant disease. And in castration-resistant disease, I want to start with a thought experiment, because overall, we don't really think of PSMA PET being very helpful or molecular imaging being helpful, because in essence, all of the systemic therapies we use in castration-resistant disease are approved in both M0 and M1 disease. But let's take a look at the Spartan trial, right? So this was a trial of apalutamide. This was the first sort of M0 CRPC study that was published. And it showed that apalutamide beat out placebo in patients with M0 CRPC. This isn't particularly shocking because apalutamide is an active drug and you're comparing it to placebo. But M0 in this study was defined as having a negative CT and a negative bone scan. And the average PSA in this population was greater than 4, right? I mean, we've been talking about, you know, sensitivities of 0.38 with PSAs less than 0.5, but when you get an average PSA of 4 with PSMA PET or even fluciclovine PET, your detection sensitivity is going to be something like 90%. So it's not too surprising that these patients actually all have M1 disease on PSMA. And we actually did that work with collaboration across seven sites with Wolfgang Fendler leading this, who is now at Essen. And we found 200 patients who met the M0 CRPC definition. And in this population, the average PSA was 5.3. And all but four patients had positive disease on PSMA PET, with 56% of the patients having disease outside of the pelvis. So you can see that PSMA PET, in essence, there is no such thing as M0 CRPC when you do PSMA PET on those patient populations. So it's going to completely change that patient population, and that patient population will go away in the future. Now, at UCSF, we designed a trial called the PILLAR trial, where we are taking patients who have M0 CRPC getting PSMA PETs and then randomizing them to getting either apalutamide alone or apalutamide plus RT to oligomets seen on PSMA PET. If you have widespread mets, you wouldn't be enrolled into the trial. And I think this is an important study because we have a lot of data in the castration-sensitive setting showing that RT to oligomets is beneficial. But in the castration-resistant setting, there actually isn't a lot of data to support the use of SBRT to treat oligometastatic disease. And it's actually being used more and more at sites that have PSMA available because we're seeing oligometastatic disease more accurately, more frequently. And so it's sort of encouraging radiation oncologists to treat that disease, but we don't have any data to support the use of that over the use of systemic therapy. Now, all of this work that we did with UCSF and UCLA in combination led to this academic collaboration, right? Both in the biochemical recurrence and in the initial staging setting. And this actually was fully enabled by the FDA's willingness to allow two paired NDAs. The FDA, I don't think, has ever done this before, where UCSF and UCLA submitted NDAs for PSMA-11 to the FDA. And the NDAs, in essence, were completely matched, except for our chemistry sections, which were obviously different because we're different facilities. But our clinical sections, Module 5 and Module 4, were completely identical and submitted to the FDA on the same day. And this led to the approval of PSMA PET, both in the setting of initial staging as well as biochemical recurrence. So this was the first radio tracer to be approved at initial staging in the setting of prostate cancer. And this was in December of last year. Now, I like to show this slide because this is not what I thought of when I thought of doing an NDA, was the enormous amount of paperwork. These are patient folders that were enrolled in this trial. We enrolled 2,000 patients nearly in our PSMA PET studies. And to go back through and clean all of these, I don't think I had a full understanding of what it took to make it through an FDA inspection from the clinical side, nor the chemistry side. There was a ton of work that went on the chemistry side as well to get everything ready for the FDA inspection to make it happen. But I think the limiting thing here with this NDA is gallium-68. And gallium-68 is a radionuclide that's eluted from a generator. Here's a generator right here, this sort of silver thing going into a synthesis module. And you can elute maybe about 35 to 40 millicuries from a 50 millicurie generator, and you can make maybe 2 to 3 doses per synthesis. And it has a 68-minute half-life, so you can't really distribute it. And so, for example, at UCSF, we elute this generator 3 times a day. So we image 6 patients per day, every day, and we have a 3-month backlog with PSMA PET because of that. And I think it just highlights how gallium PSMA 11 is not probably going to answer the need for PSMA PET in the United States. And this is where things such as DCF-PYL are going to be very important and fill a huge clinical need. So the two trials for DCF-PYL are Osprey and Condor. Osprey was their first study. These both were published actually earlier this year. In the Osprey trial, they had an initial staging cohort and a biochemical recurrence cohort. They were slightly oddly designed, the Osprey trial. The biochemical recurrence cohort required you to have biopsiable disease on conventional imaging in order to enroll, which is a little bit nonsensical because if you have biopsiable disease, you're going to have a very high PSA, and you can see here the median PSA was 11. So the FDA suggested to the company to go back and make sure that this works in patients with low PSA. So they went back and reran the biochemical recurrence cohort in the Condor study. And here you can see the baseline PSA was 0.8 in that population, a much lower PSA. And they used a correct localization rate, which is slightly different than a positive predictive value. But in essence, it's like a positive predictive value where the PSMA PET uptake had to correlate by region to their composite standard of truth. So an I would think of it as, in essence, identical to our PPV, well, which ended up being a CLR between 85 to 87% between the three readers that were used. This data is what was submitted, presumably, in the NDA for DCF-PYL and is going to lead to the approval of DCF-PYL, hopefully by the end of this month, if everything goes well, which will then be what allows patients to get access to PSMA PET across the country. Now, this availability of PSMA PET was going to impact accruing trials, both upfront and in the readout. And this is actually a big issue, is now the PSMA PET's going to be widely available maybe by this fall. It's going to take time for sites to get PSMA PET on contract and the distribution set up. But maybe by August or September, DCF-PYL is going to be widely available. So here's an example of a trial. This is GU10. This is a genomically risk stratified trial. So they take unfavorable intermediate risk prostate cancer, use Decipher score to stratify, and then take those arms to determine whether or not you're going to get RT alone. And then in the intermediate high risk Decipher score population, determine whether or not they're going to get ADT plus darolutamide or RT alone. Now, the problem here is that there's going to be a migration of patients. So if we look up in this eligibility arm, here's a patient who would have qualified for the study, right? Had a PSA of 24, Gleason 4 plus 3 disease, and he has nodal metastases supraclavicularly and mediastinally. There'd be no real way that conventional imaging, CT or bone scan, is going to see these sites of metastases. But when you get a PSMA PET up front, which this patient will a year from now, they're definitely going to get a PSMA PET with a PSA of 24. They're going to see the site of disease, and they're no longer going to randomize into that study. And so you end up having, you know, the Will Rogers effect, right? So if you think about the inclusion of patients in this trial up front, you're going to have M0 patients on conventional imaging and then conventional imaging M1 disease. This is going to be your trial population pre-PSMA. Now, when PSMA is available, you're going to have, you know, conventional imaging M1 disease, and then you're going to have PSMA M1 disease, right? So this might be what your trial population is going to be. So in those patients who are high risk, you're actually taking all the highest risk patients out of the patient population, biasing your study and actually lowering the power of your study, right? Because you're no longer going to have the patients who are going to recur in the study anymore. And sort of even worse is we know that Decipher mirrors PSMA PET. So we did a study a couple of years ago comparing Decipher scores to PSMA PETs. And not surprisingly, higher Decipher genomic classifier scores was directly associated with the presence of PSMA avid disease, right? So if you think about taking a trial as randomizing based on Decipher, and then you take out all PSMA positive disease, you're taking out, in essence, all of your bad actors and sort of ruining your trial design. And so this is going to have an impact, not just in that one trial, but many trials moving forward. You're also going to have an issue on the back end with MFS, metastasis-free survival, as an endpoint. If you think about, you know, from time of treatment, what happens to your disease volume is going to rise. You're going to be positive on PSMA PET with a relatively low PSA, but you're not going to be positive on conventional imaging till later, right? And MFS is based on conventional imaging. And this has a couple of problems. So A, if you get PSMA PET at time of biochemical recurrence, right? Biochemical recurrence is going to be the trigger for getting your PSMA PET. Those patients are going to get salvage treatment before they hit the MFS endpoint, right? So we're going to learn about when patients get biochemical recurrence and what they look like on PSMA PET. But that salvage therapy is going to push out MFS potentially in these patients who are on trial, sort of ruining your MFS endpoint. And the problem is, again, these PSMA PETs probably aren't going to be done at a standard time. They're going to be done at time of a PSA rise. And so your PSMA PET progression is going to now migrate up to biochemical free survival. And we know that biochemical free survival is not correlated with overall survival, which is going to be a problem. So how we define progression also is a problem on a PSMA PET, particularly in patients who didn't have a PSMA at baseline. So if you have a trial that's running that doesn't have a PSMA PET at baseline, and now we're getting a PSMA PET at biochemical recurrence, we don't know if that patient progressed or not. So how do we even define progression if a patient didn't have PSMA PET at baseline? So there's all these issues that are going to come in at time of progression in clinical trials. Okay, So now I'm going to move on to maybe the most exciting portion of this talk is the idea of theranostics. So theranostics is the use of a compound for both diagnostics and therapeutics, right? So again, here's a molecule, has the urea motif on one end, has a chelator, in this case was a DOTA chelator on the other end. The DOTA chelator can bind to gallium for imaging, but also things such as lutetium or yttrium-90 or actinium-225 for therapy. Now, this was really brought to the forefront with this Australian phase two trial in 2018 by Mike Hoffman and his group at Peter MacCallum Institute. And this was very exciting. This was a patient population, heavily pretreated, who had mostly gotten prior chemotherapy and abiraterone or enzalutamide. And then they treated them with up to four cycles of lutetium PSMA 617. And you can see over half of the patients had greater than 50% reduction in their PSA after treatment, which is very impressive in such a heavily pretreated population, especially when not using an AR-targeted therapy. Obviously, when you target the androgen receptor, you're going to have a decrease in PSA, but that sometimes is artifactual because the androgen receptor modulates PSMA, so PSA. And so here, when you're using a treatment that doesn't directly inhibit AR and you have such a good PSA response, that's very impressive. Now, this was followed up by the therapy trial. This was published in Lancet this year. And this compared lutetium PSMA 617 to capazitaxel. And you can see very nicely here that, again, lutetium PSA has a much better reduction in PSA overall. And there's a slight improvement in progression-free survival with PSMA-targeted radioligand therapy compared to cabazitaxel. The overall survival data here hasn't read out, but overall, the PSMA-617 was better tolerated than cabazitaxel, and it was a really an impressive study, and really nice to see a study like this come out of academia. Because a company probably would never be willing to risk doing a head-to-head of cabazitaxel to lutetium PSMA 617. And this was really an active comparator showing the benefit of PSMA 617 compared to an active comparator. Now, there is a large number of PSMA radioligand therapy trials out there. So I just listed a number of them here. There's, you know, at least four company-sponsored ones. There's Vision. This is the phase three trial that is finished enrollment, and I'm sure many of you saw the press release from AAA showing that this had positive results. I've never seen a press release that had positive results but didn't have any of the results in them, and they will be presenting this at ASCO in an oral talk in June, so we'll be very excited to see the actual results from this study. But then there's the PSMA-4. This is in essence moving PSMA up front, and that should say PSMA 617 here, not INT, prior to chemotherapy in the CRPC. There's also a actinium trial. There's a trial looking in the pre-chemotherapy setting, and there's actually another Novartis trial looking at 617 in the pre-chemo setting as well. And then you have the ENZA-P trial, which is PSMA plus enzalutamide versus enzalutamide LuPARP, looking at the combination therapy with olaparib. You have a CCTG trial doing PSMA 617 versus docetaxel. And then you have this Bullseye trial, et cetera. And there's many more out there that are being done, but the field is really growing very quickly. Now, for me, I think we're still in a very, very early stage. This was a paper published in 2019 showing theoretically the benefit of PSMA radioligand therapy. So here's a patient, came in, PSA of 755, got four cycles of PSMA radioligand therapy. His PSA became undetectable. Then a year later, he comes back, has a PSA recurrence. PSA is now 5.5, gave four more cycles, 0.3. Comes back now. You can see here only 5 months later, PSA is 8, got four more cycles, PSA was 4. Now, comes back 4 months later, PSA is 32, four more cycles, is PSA 15. Now, each of these times, PSMA 617 lutetium-labeled therapy was effective, and he got, you know, quite a number of years of benefit over this, 5 years. But I think it's nonsensical that we're giving four cycles every time sort of blindly with the same dose without really taking into account any patient-specific factors. And I think we're just sort of blindly hitting things with these therapies without being intelligent about the way we're using radioligand therapy. So in my perspective, I think we need to understand how patients respond to radioligand therapy. And so I think of patients having sort of low or high radiosensitivity in terms of their tumor sensitivity, and they have either high or low absorbed dose, right? So the amount of radioactivity to the tumors is going to vary dramatically, maybe tenfold across patients. And so what we really want is to treat high radiation sensitivity patients with a high dose to their tumors. And those are the patients who are going to do well. And so we are running a trial at UCSF where we're doing biopsies and dosimetry in patients treated with lutetium PSMA to try to tease apart how much of that response is based upon the sensitivity of the tumor versus the amount of dose that goes to that tumor. And I'm working with Felix Fang in radiation oncology, who's doing a lot of the genomics to try to do the radiation sensitivity side of this trial. And clearly, dosimetry matters. Remember I said there's an Australian phase two trial. This was a dosimetry publication that's associated with that study, published by John Violet. And here you can see that in patients who had a higher dose, they had the patients who had a PSA response that was greater than 50% decrease had a higher dose than those who did not, right? So the higher amount of radioactivity you get to the tumor, the more likely you are to respond. And if you got less than 10 gray, you in essence had no chance of responding. So clearly there's sort of a ceiling you had to get above to respond. But even within that ceiling, not all the patients responded well. And this is probably due to intrinsic radiation sensitivity of the tumors. The other thing we're looking at is, can we modulate PSMA expression? So a number of years ago, we did this study looking at inhibiting the androgen receptor with abiraterone. And this was with Michael Evans at UCSF, who was one of the first people to publish the fact that inhibition of the androgen receptor led to higher PSMA uptake. So these were mice treated with just saline. If you did an orchiectomy or gave abiraterone, you can see that the PSMA expression went up. And the first patient we imaged after, before and after giving ADT, this was a castration-sensitive patient, had a marked increase in PSMA expression after giving ADT. This, as you'll see in a second, didn't play out the way we had anticipated. This patient actually ended up being primarily resistant. His PSA never went to zero, and he had biochemical recurrence about 7 months after initiation of ADT, which is unusual in the patient in the castration-sensitive setting. When we did look at patients and multiple patients before and after, and this here is in patients with castration-sensitive disease, some patients had their PSA go up, or PSMA PET uptake go up. Some had them go down. And I think what this is if you have sensitive disease to androgen receptor inhibition, your PSMA uptake goes down because you're killing the disease. And then there's probably tumors where when your androgen receptor is inhibited, the PSMA uptake will go up because you have that upregulation of PSMA. Now, Louise Emmett from St. Vincent's did sort of the same type of work we did and did a much better job of it, I should say. And she did multiple time points, 9, 18, 28 days in castration sensitive and resistant patients, and saw sort of the same noise that not every patient went up or down, and it was sort of all over the place. But that led her to design this ENZA-P trial, and she was much more thoughtful about this, this idea of adding lutetium PSMA to enzalutamide in the castration resistant setting. And the idea here is that if you have failure of enzalutamide, right, enzalutamide is not treating the patient well, that is a patient where your PSMA expression is going to go up, right? Because you're not killing off the tumor cells, you're going to have upregulation of PSMA. And those are the patients where you can wipe clean the disease with lutetium PSMA. And so this is currently enrolling, and I'll be very excited to see the results of this study, hopefully maybe next year. Now, we also took sort of a different approach. We tried to look and see if we can modulate PSMA expression using CRISPR screens. So in collaboration with Luke Gilbert and Thomas O'Loughlin, we implemented a CRISPR screen in prostate cancer cell lines. And what you can do here is you can turn off every single gene in the genome, one gene per cell. And then you can let those cells grow and then sort them in a fax machine and see which cells have high or low PSMA expression to then take out and see which genes, when you inhibit them, does it increase PSMA expression. And so by doing this approach, we actually found, not surprisingly, that PSMA, if you turn on PSMA, it obviously leads to a very high increase in expression of PSMA expression. But if you inhibit things like RRM1 or CDK4, you can increase PSMA expression. And so we are going to enroll in a trial right now with CDK4 inhibition to hopefully show that when you inhibit that, you increase PSMA expression and potentiate the effect of PSMA radioligand therapy by getting more dose to the tumor. And so we're working with Vadim Koshin in medical oncology to do that. The other thing we're doing is looking back at this Australian phase two trial. Although this did look very optimistic, the PSMA progression-free survival, PSA progression-free survival in this population was only 7.6 months. Patients here were getting four cycles. Four cycles were given every 6 weeks. And so in essence, right when patients completed their fourth cycle, patients started progressing, had PSA progression. And so it's not a very durable response, which is what led us to run this trial. So we're doing a study of PSMA 617 in combination with pembrolizumab. And this is a sort of an unusual study. We had sort of a run-in phase where we gave pembrolizumab before, during, or after the first dose of PSMA 617 to see if there's an effect of the timing of the pembrolizumab in terms of the PSMA administration. And now that we finished that, we're actually now completing our dose expansion where we're doing PSMA 617 with pembrolizumab. The thing that's really unusual is we're only giving one dose of PSMA 617 instead of doing the four or six cycles like the VISION trial or the Australian group. We're only giving one dose. And the benefit of that is we're really going to be able to see much better how the pembrolizumab is improving the durability, right? Because with only one cycle, we can see how long the biochemical free survival is in the setting of giving pembrolizumab in combination. The Peter McCallum group is doing a similar trial, but they're giving four cycles of PSMA 617 with pembrolizumab. And I think it's gonna be much harder to tease apart that benefit of the pembrolizumab when you're giving so many cycles of PSMA 617. So I'll be excited to see how this plays out. And this is being done with Rahul Agarwal and Larry Fong at UCSF. So in summary, PSMA PET is superior to existing radiotracers for the detection of metastatic prostate cancer. Two, the use of PSMA PET has a large impact on clinical care, in particular in terms of how radiation therapy planning is done. Gallium PSMA 11 is approved, and there's actually one more NDA pending for gallium PSMA 11. There's a kit made by Telix, which also might be FDA approved this month. And there's obviously also another NDA under review for GCF-PYL, which hopefully will get approved by the end of this month as well. And then last, PSMA-targeted radioligand therapy is really poised for clinical translation. And I think by the end of this year, there's a good chance that lutetium PSMA 617 will be FDA approved, really sort of closing the doors on the opening of PSMA radioligand therapy. And so I wanted to thank a number of people at UCSF. This isn't even anywhere near totally inclusive, but it took a huge team to get all this work done with both the radioligand therapy side and the PSMA PET side. And then obviously I want to thank my funders. The Prostate Cancer Foundation has always been a very supportive group in helping our work out. And then obviously the National Cancer Institute supported me with a number of grants over the time that I've been working on these projects. And I really want to thank them. And then obviously also thank my family who hopefully aren't awake listening to me talk this early in the morning. So thank you all very much. And David, I'll hand it back to you.
Thank you, Dr. Hope, for that fascinating talk. If you have any questions, please use the Q&A feature located at the bottom of the screen. And while we wait on questions, and I see a few in the chat already, I wanted to let you know the next week's Grand Round will feature Winship's own Mehmet Akshay, who's presenting rapidly evolving landscape and future horizons in hepatocellular carcinoma treatment. To view all upcoming Winship Grand Round lectures, please visit the Grand Rounds page on the Winship Cancer Center website or the Winship calendar. Tom, we have a few questions, but I'd like to start off with one. When we are going to be doing a PSMA PRRT for, let's say, metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancer, do you think that we should routinely image with not only PSMA PET, but also FDG PET, kind of on the same, you know, lines that we're talking about for neuroendocrine tumor, certain types?
So David, just to make sure we don't do this. So PRT is specifically used when you're using a peptide. There's okay. No peptide with PSMA, so it's a radioligand therapy. So yeah. Make sure we get our nomenclature appropriate. So yeah, so the idea of imaging with FDG is really important in patient selection. Now, I don't think it's important in following the patient after therapy, but it's important for determining if a patient would be a good candidate for therapy. The problem we're going to run into in the United States is we're not going to get paid for an FDG PET and a PSMA PET. So you run into this issue of, okay, well, which PET are you going to choose? I mean, you could even do a fluciclovine PET and a PSMA PET. I mean, I think fluciclovine would be equivalent to FDG in the setting as well, right? You're just looking for sites of disease that are PSMA negative. Okay. The one thing I don't think has been well described in the literature is in the patients who are FDG positive, PSMA negative, how many of those would have been missed by conventional imaging? What I mean by that is, you know, they, if you look in the publications we've seen from Peter Mack, you have liver mets that are FDG positive and PSMA negative. Well, I mean, no one's going to miss that on a PSMA only study. So I'm not totally clear on the added benefit of adding FDG to PSMA. Clearly, it sees heterogeneous disease, but could you use diffusion weighted MRI? Would you be able to see all these lesions on in other ways to be able to see that? Maybe whole body diffusion plus a PSMA PET would be able to be equivalent to FDG. But there's definitely a benefit in that setting. I don't know how it's going to play out clinically.
Interesting. Okay, some questions in our chat from Dr. Johnny. Great talk. Will be interesting to see results of randomized trial you mentioned with PSMA from the UCLA group with Calais and post-op salvage setting results and the post-op setting results and how they generally look in comparison with Empire One. Do you know how far that trial is into accrual and when we can see it in abstract or published form? Our direct comparison trial between PSMA and fluciclovine in Empire Two is midway through, actually over midway through its 140 accrual goal.
Well, that's great news about Empire too. I'm really excited to see that. So the Calais paper finished enrollment. So they published their, this is our paper, patient population and what the disease, you know, just like the JNM paper you guys published. So that is done. And so when it will read out, I think their endpoint is I think they go out to 5 years, but I think a 3-year analysis, I can't exactly remember off the top of my head. So I would bet the last patient in, I think was last fall.
Okay.
So it would be 2023 probably.
Got it. Excellent. Okay. Now from Dr. Harris, clinical practice is rapidly changing based on the ability to visualize previously undetectable disease. In a practical sense, can we ever address the issue of stage migration, lead time bias, and length time bias? Can we ever know that these new technologies actually benefit anyone? Is there a strategy for defining the costs and potential morbidity of overtreatment?
Yeah, well, that's a really good question. So I think lead time bias is relevant if you're comparing studies head to head, right? So if you're going to have a study of high-risk patients before and after PSMA PET, you can't compare the outcome, right? Because you're going to have the Will Rogers effect and everyone's going to look better, right? So that's an issue when comparing trial data. Now, to show that PSMA PET is valuable, I mean, in all honesty, the trial that you're running is really important.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a lot of trial data that shows that treating oligometastatic disease, the STOMP trial, Empire One, Jeremy Calais trial is all very valuable. But we're going to come into a problem where you're not going to be able to randomize patients to PSMA PET versus not PSMA PET, in essence, now, right? So no trial is going to be able to do that moving forward. So we're going to end up having PSMA PET both in the control arm and the treatment arm. And so I think the trial data is going to be very, very limited. Now, you get that comment quite a lot. No one ever asked if a CT scan caused lead time bias and whether or not we should do CT scan. No one ever said, hey, should we do MRs or fluciclovines? It's 100% clear the PSMA PET's better. It localizes disease. It has a very good specificity and sensitivity. And it's a little funny of an argument to say, hey, why we shouldn't do the better imaging study because, you know, we don't know all in every single clinical setting if it has a benefit. So I agree that there's going to be a bias. I think the important thing is just to realize that that bias exists when you're looking at trial data, that you can't compare apples to oranges. And that when you're evaluating patients in a PSMA PET screened trial, and also when the PSMA PET uses it in the readout, that you're not able to compare that to the trial data that existed before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and actually we made a point in the Lancet article that bone scanning was introduced without any of this evidence, and it's the standard of care. So, and then One final question, great talk, especially in heavily pretreated MCRPC, heterogeneity is a big issue, which might cause different PSMA expression. Maybe this is reflecting on what I asked before. What do you think about the long-term durability of PSMA-based treatments, either radioligand or BiTEs, and how to overcome it?
That's a great question. So the durability, I tried to sort of address that in the talk, which is I think the heterogeneity, hopefully we can overcome it a little bit by giving things like CDK4/6 mm-hmm. inhibitors to increase expression. Bites, I think, are a totally different beast. What I mean by that is it's not clear to me that there's a dose response to bites. Mm-hmm. You know, you might not need to have high, like clearly with radioligand therapy, the higher the dose, the better you do, right? There's a linearish relationship with noise caused by intrinsic sensitivity. Bites probably don't have a linear relationship between dose and response. Mm-hmm. And so that heterogeneity, bites might do better in patients with low PSMA expression than radioligand therapy. So I think you have to think of them as two completely different things. Mm-hmm. And in all honesty, we have incredibly little data on the PSMA target bite field. So, you know, hopefully in the near future, some of the Amgen trials will start reading out and we'll get some information on that, but we're not there yet. In terms of durability, as I said, we're just scratching the surface here, right? We're at the very beginning of using this and I have no idea where we're going to go. And there's going to be combination therapies, priming, dose changes. You know, this idea of giving 200 millicuries every 6 weeks times six doses is a Luddite thought, right? And we know that that's not where we're going to be in 10 years. It's just, I don't know what that's going to look like though. So it's going to be very different.
Definitely, definitely. And it could be, we can make a big impact or the biology gets you in the end. So, you know, we'll see. Thank you, Dr. Hope. We have no more questions. And again, you have the information to get your CME credits and we'll sign off now. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much for the invitation. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.